Because the cow has the udder. Brum, brum, brum. Okay. This is a true story, this next one, by Grandpa and his granddaughter, like you would find in Reader's Digest back in the day. There was a 5-year-old granddaughter who asked her granddaddy, "How old are you, Grandpa? How old are you?" And he answered, 65. "What's next?" he answered. She thought a minute. She knew she was 5 turning 6, and she was a smartie, so she said, 66. "Very, very good. What's next?" And she thought a minute. "The nursing home?" Yes, yeah, children are tons of time. Interesting. Are there any first-timers here today? I'm looking. Stop. All family. Wonderful. We'll now have a moment of silence for all those in our church family who aren't with us today, which is many, and who are experiencing health or other life challenges. Please keep, during this time, Betty Fleming and her sisters and her family in your prayers. Her mother recently made her transition at age 98. And there will be a memorial service next Saturday, Our Lady of Hope, at Little Mac and Martin in St. Clair Shores. Please let Betty know today if you'll be here because she needs the numbers for a food count. Thank you for your prayers for them. And also for Dee DeWitt, who has a health challenge right now. She would love any phone calls from any of you guys. And she really misses everybody. All right, be still. Thank you, God. Greg Everett will now come read today's daily word.
Expect only good. Unity minister Eric Butterworth writes in Spiritual Economics, "You do not receive what you want, you do not receive what you pray for, not even what you say you have faith in. You will always receive what you actually expect. Each morning, even when clouds cover the sky, I expect the sun to rise. When I drift off to sleep, I expect to awake and refresh. When I express the desires of my heart in prayer, all my expectations limited, or do I expect only good? As I pray, if I discover a thought of lack or limitation, I remember that I am living a living expression of God, heir to all that God is. I release the limiting thought gently and without judgment. Free from thoughts of limitation, I expect only good, and my good comes to me. Do not be afraid, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." Luke 12:32.
Thank you, Greg. We will all now sing a hymn in your bulletin insert, "Surely the Presence," together.
Thank you.
all, both indivisible and visible, one presence, one mind, one power is all. This one that is all is perfect life, perfect love, and perfect substance. I am an individualized expression of God. I am ever one with this perfect life, perfect love, and perfect substance. On your own, you can read the purpose and mission statements found on the back of your bulletin. If you miss getting your letter to God in the envelope, they're in the back of the sanctuary. We'll be announcing this for the today and next Sunday. You can pick them up on your way out, and after you write your letter to God, you can seal the envelope, put your own address on it, give it to Betty Fleming. If she's not available, just go to the end of the hall and slide it underneath the office door. And what's really neat, in 6 months, you get it back. It feels very weird to get something in the mail with your own handwriting on it, but it's really, really wonderful to read all the blessings that God has brought you in that 6 months. In 6 months, the church will be on the baptism. Remember, next Sunday, for Sunday is Money Tree Sunday, so bring your change bags, banks with you. They'll be collected with the regular offering. This money is used for kitchen supplies, paper products, cleaning supplies, that kind of thing. So we thank you in advance for that. Now, there's a lot in the bulletin insert, on the blue insert. So I'm going to try to keep this as brief as possible. If I miss anything, please let me know. Reiki Day for February has been canceled. The next Reiki Day will be Tuesday, March 3rd. There will be a sign-up sheet near the bookstore next month. If you want individual Reiki for the cost of $10 that goes to the church, please see Mary Ann Primmons, Roseanne Rousseau, or myself, and we will schedule a date that works for you anytime between now and that March Reiki Day on the 3rd. Linda Ridley's class wanted to start today. She wanted it to start today, but because of the interesting weather again, it will start next Sunday. And is that 11:45? 11:45 to about 1. And it's healing. Help me with the title.
Healing Within.
Love it. Healing Within. And I have been in many of her classes, and not only do we learn, it is very fun at the same time. We're so glad you're doing that with us. There will not be church choir practice today, but we will practice next Sunday at 9:30 in our rooms to sing on Sunday.
No stewardship meeting today.
No stewardship meeting either. Thank you. All right. Prayer, if you would like individual, personal, confidential prayer after the service, I will be up here, and if you want to be a prayer partner and give back that way, when Judy Kerman comes back, you can see her or me about that. We do need people still to volunteer in the sound area, and you will get personalized training if you would like to give back in that way. We would appreciate the help immensely. We're so glad to have Mike on camera. Yes, thank you so much for giving back. So much. Okay, today we welcome wonderful Brianna Guttmacher on keyboard, and for the first time this new year, Bobby George on guitar. We are also happy to welcome for the first time today Mr. Ben Walker. His talk today is entitled, I Will Rise Up. Mr. Walker was a teacher in Flint, Warren, and Grosse Pointe. Principal of Grosse Pointe South High School. He studied 2 full summers at Unity Village and was a musical director at the Church of Dead Today under Jack Boland. He also worked with Marianne Williamson on several of her projects when she was a spiritual leader of Renaissance Unity. For the past 5 years, he's been on a grant from the Methodist Union developing curriculum and programs for youth. Reverend Norm introduced him 2 weeks ago as co-facilitator with him for our church Course of Miracles study. I encourage you to come. It's really been wonderful. Let's give Mr. Walker a warm and peace welcome this morning. We will now sing to our Father, followed by Mr. Walker's meditation.
In our meditation today, we want to leave this world behind. Everything that we see and experience out there, the weather, the problems, we want to leave it behind. We want to go to that place within us, that secret place, where God Himself dwells. So I'm going to ask you to make yourself comfortable. Find a position where you can sit comfortably. Ground yourself by putting your feet flat on the floor, if possible, if that's comfortable for you. Rest your hands in the way so that your body is as less problematic to you as possible. Our meditation today is going to be on resting in God. Take a deep breath in, and with it, feel the Spirit of God that is in this place, surely in this place, and in you. As you breathe out, let go of the world. On the in-breath again, feeling God, and letting go of the world. Today we're asking to find God's dwelling place within us. We're asking for quietness, for rest, unshaken by the noise and the insanity of the outer world. Today we seek peace and stillness in the midst of all the outer turmoil. We're asking to find safety and happiness. I rest in God. I rest in God. Say that quietly within your own mind and feel the wonder of the words. I rest. Rest in God. This very thought, I rest in God, will bring you to the very gates of heaven. It will awaken the powerful truth within you that you are a part of, a vital part of God Himself. Indeed, that without you, God would be somehow incomplete. Again, say quietly to yourself, I rest in God. Let this truth carry you past all of your worries today, past all of your problems, for with God there is no suffering. With God there are no problems. There is no illness God cannot heal, and no need that He cannot supply. I rest. God. I rest in God. Let this be a day of peace for you. So while this outer world is torn with hate, with despair, you remain completely undisturbed. For your mind, your soul, is at rest in God. In God, your creator and source, you have no cares, no fears, no burdens, no anxiety, no pain, and no fear for the future. Quietly, make a commitment to God to rest in Him throughout this day and all days. Say to God in your mind, in your heart, Father God, I rest in you. And every day, look at every opportunity to take a minute, several if possible, as often as you can, in the turmoil, to rest in God. Because your holy mind is one with God and with all that is alive, when you rest in God, you bring rest to the entire universe. You bring the miracle of peace to all who are willing to accept it. Think on this. Each time you take your rest in God, Somewhere a sad soul, an unhappy soul, is suddenly gladdened and doesn't know why. But it's because you rest in God and that energy goes out into the universe wherever it's needed. Somewhere, a wing, a broken-winged bird, begins to fly and suddenly finds a new life. Each time you rest in God, a miracle happens somewhere, and a stream, long dry, begins to run again. But mostly the tired and weary minds of your brothers are suddenly made glad. Rest. Rest in God. And the world is born again when you join your mind with God. Now take a moment in the silence of your own mind to just find that rest, that peace. And invite it to be with you today and always. And having that peace and that rest for yourself, you can now let it radiate out from you to every brother in this room, to every brother and everyone in this community, in this country, on this globe. We rest in God. So we have been refreshed by God's presence, by finding ourselves where we really are always, in the Father, one with God, one with God. When we feel ready, gently come back to what seems to be the world, but it's only a place where we play out a part of our lives. Our real world is inside. Bring that with you. In the name of God, whose name is our own. Amen.
Most people are good, and most mothers are qualified for saint good. I believe most right. recognize, put the banner underneath on my stadium lights. I believe you love will be loving, nothing you should ever be ashamed of. I believe this world ain't half as bad as it looks.
Different meaning story says. And it can be understood on three levels. Some people take the story literally, that everything that's told in that story is meant, just what it is. And if you do that, you're usually left a little puzzled about what was really going on. The second meaning of a parable, or a way to understand it, is a little deeper. It's a little more spiritual, but it still doesn't get down to the nitty-gritty. And this is where most traditional churches, kind of churches I grew up in, I grew up in a Southern Baptist and Methodist combination, and we were as fundamentalist as I could be. But how many of you came from a more fundamentalist background? I'm interested in knowing. Some of you grew up in Unity. Oh, if you did, you were so lucky. Oh my goodness, how blessed you were. And the third way is to really dig deep to find the truth. But parables always speak to your deeper mind, to your spiritual mind. Jesus knew that. So when he would tell these stories, he was really not talking to the obvious. He was talking to your deeper self. Parables were Jesus' primary way of teaching. There are 44 full parables in what is called a standard Bible. And if you get into the lost books of the Bible, I don't really like that term because they're not really lost, but you know what I mean, the books that were not included, we find another 100 parables. So I want to put ourselves in the time of Jesus. And I'm going to ask you to imagine yourselves living in Galilee. And you are ordinary people. Some of you are sheep herders. Some of you are carpenters. Some of you may be women who have gone to the well to get water. You might be a Roman soldier because you would be stationed in one of those little towns. Ordinary people, and almost no one really educated. Women certainly, sadly, would have had no education. And the men who had an education, basically, if they were Jewish, only had a religious education. So this is the audience Jesus talked to. So let's see ourselves. Let's take this church and put it in Palestine 2,000 years ago. And you're walking along doing your business, and over there you see this guy talking. And you stop to listen. And he tells you the story. And you get interested. He says, once there was a wealthy man who had a beautiful farm, and he had two sons. That kind of interests you. You think I'll listen to the rest of it. He said, one of those sons came one day to his dad and said, Dad, I want to take my inheritance, and I'm going to leave this place. And I'm going to go away. I want to go far away from here, to a far country. And the father was really saddened to hear this. But he had given his son's free will. So he said, Son, this breaks my heart, but here's your inheritance. And the boy takes it and travels far, far away. Well, when he gets there, he meets all kinds of people who are happy to help him with his inheritance. Right? Yeah, a lot hasn't changed. Well, they're happy to help him drink it away, to gamble it away, to do anything. And quickly, the fortune is gone. It's gone. And at the same time, a terrible famine hits the land. There's no food. There are no jobs. And here the son is, far away from home. And he searches and he searches for work. And the only job he can find is the worst thing a Jewish boy could do. A job working in a pigsty. Dirty, filthy, smelly work. And Orthodox Jews would have nothing to do with pork or swine. And here he is, that's the only job he can have. And so daily he goes to work, and he is miserable. He's miserable It becomes dirty and smelly, saddened by its state. And he can hardly stand it. And one day he thinks to himself, oh my gosh, if I were only back at my father's. The servants at my father's home have a better life than I have. If I could just go back, maybe my father would take me back, not as a son, but as a servant. And so, this is the important line I want you to hold on to. The Bible says, Jesus said clearly, I will rise up. I will rise up from this place of misery and go back to my Father. I will rise up from the filth. I will rise up from the mystery, and I will go back to my Father. And so he does. So he starts the journey back. Dirty, smelly, walking, hungry, I can imagine. And he's frightened to see his dad. But he says, I would just plead with my father, just let me be a servant. But then Jesus tells us, the father came out on the porch of the beautiful big farmhouse, and he looked down the road, and he saw his son. And he was so overjoyed that he ran from the house. He ran down the road and he threw his arms around his son. He said, welcome home. My son, you were dead, but now you are alive. Let us go back to the house. And he told the servants, kill the fatted calf. We're going to have a great, great banquet. And he sent for a robe to put on his son's shoulders and sandals, put on those tired, dirty feet, and he even put a golden ring on his finger. Well, that would be a wonderful, happy ending to the parable. Ah, but then something happens. The older brother, who was out in the fields, comes rushing in to see all this going on. And what does he do? Does he say, oh, my brother is home, let me love him? No, he yells at his father. What is this? What is this? I have served you, and I have done the work on this farm, and you've never even given me a lamb to share with my friends. And yet you give this son of yours, who betrayed you and left you, a golden ring and a great banquet. How can this be? And the father said to the older son, my son, you're with me always. But this son was lost, and he's been found. And let us rejoice that the one who is dead is alive. And that ends the story. Now, everybody standing there in the village probably really thought that was kind of interesting. And knowing Jesus, making it sound like I know him personally, but I feel like I do actually, I think he probably told the story with quite a bit of emphasis, as he did all the parables. But what did he want us to know from the story? Now, when you study any parable, here's something really important for you to keep in mind. In a parable, every single character is yourself. They're not different people, they're you. So you're the son. Just the fact that you're listening to this, you're the son, and you are the elder brother, and you are the father. Now we have to kind of put the puzzle together a little bit. Now the traditional church always wants to tell it that the son is a sinner and that the father is God and God welcomed him back. And that kind of works, except the brother gets in the way. Do you know that there were actually a movement at one time to take the story of the elder brother out of it altogether? when they were editing the Bible way back in 300, let's take that elder son out. Why did Jesus include me? Now here is the story. Relate to this. All of us were created by God. All of us were created by God as a part of Himself. You are the Father. You're not all of the Father, but you're part of the Father. You're part of the Father, and you're part of the Father. All of us are. If any of us weren't there, God would be incomplete. So, we start with that premise. We are one with God. But a part of us, and you know that part in yourself as well as I know it in myself, decides that's not enough. Can you believe that? It's not enough to be part of God. I've got to go off and do it all on my own. I know a lot better than God how to make me happy. I know a lot better than God how to run the world. Don't we all say that? Don't we all do that all the time? Instead of going to God, to the totality of God, we drift off. We know better. And then what do? It may not always be as extreme, but we usually end up in a pigsty. Have you ever been there? Have you ever been in a place in your life where the mess just seems unbearable? If we're honest, most of us have that. When you dig a hole so deep, you don't know if you can get out of it. Where family problems, where poverty, where divorce, where drugs, where addiction, all the issues are so great. And you can hardly stand it anymore. You want to get out of that. And when you're wise, and when you come from a place like unity, you will say, I will rise up. I'm going to a higher level of thinking. I'm going to go from wrong action to right action. I'm going to go from wrong thinking to right thinking. You rise up, and then you think you'll give God another chance. Have you ever done that in your life? Well, church was all right for a while, but it's been 10 years since I've been there. So maybe I'll go back and have a little bit of a need. I couldn't get this all solved by myself, so maybe I will try prayer. Couldn't get the world's problems all solved, so I'll pick up a daily word. You know what I'm saying. We get on that road to go back. And the totality of God, the fullness of God, brings us right back in. It says, you're part of me. You're dead, but you're really alive now. You are a part of me. But then there's that part about that pesky elder son. And he is you also. He is the you that is so critical of everything. He's the you that finds fault with every driver on the road. He's the you that gets upset at every restaurant. He's the you that finds everything wrong with the world. And he's the you that more than anything will not forgive yourself. You won't forgive yourself. You won't forgive yourself for the mistakes that you've done. You won't forgive yourself and believe that God can take you back and make you as perfect as you always were. All of us live with an elder son inside of us. You met him somewhere today, right? You met him out here on Metropolitan Parkway. You met him in the bathroom, or you met him when your husband got up, or when your kid forgot to turn on the coffee, and it was just like, the world is against me. That's the elder son. Critical. But the biggest thing about the elder son is lack of self-forgiveness. In this far country that we've all come to, is a place of mistakes. It's a place where we don't do everything right. to forgive yourself. And when you do, the most wondrous thing happens. Because actually, the one that we need to forgive the most for everything is ourselves. So today, be gentle with yourself. When you find yourself being critical out there about every driver, about the game being too loud in the restaurant you're in, or whatever, just stop and think. This is just life. It is what it is. And when you feel yourself being unkind and critical that somebody else did well, what? That awful neighbor of mine down the street, the one who makes all that noise, won the lottery? How can that be? How's that possible? And look, the kids from that family, they bought the mother. What a beautiful gift they gave her for Mother's Day. I got some roses from the corner. Elder son. You know, I can see on your face, you know it. His name is our own, right? His name is our own. Forgive others. In the Course in Miracles, there's a part on forgiveness that I love, and I'm really influenced by the Course in Miracles. It's my spiritual guide. It says that God does not forgive. Ooh, it's a huge statement. God does not forgive. But there's another part to it. God does not forgive because God has never condemned. There's nothing to forgive. Nevertheless, the love of God is what will give us the strength to forgive in this world. So, when you find yourself in a position where you're angry, upset, just think to yourself, I can go to God's love and forgive this person. Maybe more importantly, I can go to God's love and forgive myself. And then, like the boy in the story, you're home. You're home. And the Father, the completeness of God, just wraps around you. He says, I love you. I love you. You are lost. But now you're found. You are lost. But now you're found. Join me in prayer, please. Great Creator God, who created us all as one perfect being. No matter what our outer circumstances may seem like, we are a part of you, and when we live in you, and when we go to you, you lead us in pastures of green. You lead us beside still waters. Our cup overflows with goodness. All go back to God. Make an inner commitment to go back to God. For there we will find true welcome. In the name of God, whose name is your own. In the name of God, whose name is your own. Amen. Thank you, God.
Thank you.
front door. Don't forget the keys under the mat. Childhood star shine, always stay humble and kind. Go to church, cause your mama says to you, this is rare, born in the chance that you can. Won't be wasted time, always stay humble and kind. Don't hold a grudge or a chip, here's why. Bitterness keeps you from flying. Always stay humble and kind. Know the difference between stealing someone, sleeping with someone you love. A money win, no big old line. So always stay humble and kind. Hot, eat a root, beer, popsicle. Shut off the AC and roll the windows down. Let that summer sun shine. Always stay humble and kind. Don't take for granted love like you do. When you get where you're going, don't forget to turn back around. Help the next one in line. Always stay humble and kind. Humble and kind. Always stay humble and
Thank you.
God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us.